It was a challenging time for all Americans. The world was at war. What people needed more than anything else was a few hours where they could just get away from it all. They found it at the movies. For a quarter, moviegoers could take a two-hour break from the problems of the world, escaping into a silver screen world of action, romance, adventure, and always a cartoon.
We're whooping it up.
When it came to these cartoons, there was one animator who stood apart from the rest, with a dazzling signature style that was all his own. His cartoons were faster and funnier than anyone had ever seen. Today, this groundbreaking animator is remembered for creating some of the zaniest cartoons ever. In doing so, perhaps more than anyone else, he shaped the way we all think of cartoons today. His name was Fred Tex Avery.
Tex Avery was born in 1908 in a small Texas town called Taylor, and he went to Dallas High School, and he drew cartoons for the yearbook. He wanted very much to be a comic strip artist, so he rode with a bunch of friends to Los Angeles. He wasn't having any luck selling his comic strip, so he said, well, I'm going to try to do really well in animation, and I'll concentrate on that. This led to a job with the Warner Brothers Cartoon Studio, and it's here that the real legend of Tex Avery starts to take root.
At Warner Brothers, Avery began to explore and refine the art of the gag and develop a style that was all his own. Avery wanted people to laugh at his cartoons, and to that end, he played a key role in creating some of the funniest and best-loved cartoon characters of all time.
Tex happened to be a resource of the studio, and everybody wanted to work with him.
He was one of three directors at Warner Brothers at that time, but his films seemed to be funnier than anybody else's, mainly because they were faster paced. He's the one who really sped things up for the Hollywood cartoon.
After a few years, Tex Avery left Warner Brothers and brought his unique style for faster, funnier cartoons to MGM.
It's that style of animation. It's the very, you know, exaggerated takes. It's everything to do when you say squash and stretch. That's what it is. The characters are squashed and they're stretched.
And it was there, at MGM, where Avery's full talent blossomed, where he turned cartoon gags into an art form.
MGM was one of the richest studios in Hollywood at that time. They did lavish musicals. They had a fabulous orchestra, you know, grand sound stages. And all that was also used by the people who made the short animated films. So there was a real boost in terms of quality, production values when he moved to MGM. He could hire fantastic animators, and there was a lavishness to the backgrounds, and that also pervaded the music as well. So there was a real quality to the MGM package of shorts, and including the Droopy shorts.
Hello, Joe.
How about a kiss, eh?
Droopy Dog was one of the first characters Avery created at MGM. And in Droopy, we see virtually everything that made Tex Avery cartoons so unique.
Happy landing.
The little guy made his big screen debut, starring in a film called Dumbhounded.
Hello, all you happy people. You know what? I'm the hero.
Very much in his first film, a dog-like character.
Dog talk.
Whereas later he became like a little man in a dog suit.
All right, boys. A one, a two.
He seemed to pair him with this wonderful, wild, lively wolf.
Glad to see you too.
Who was always surprised by Droopy.
Peek-a-boo.
He was replaced later by a bulldog named Spike.
Droopy, how about a nice big handout for your old pal Spike, huh? I'm starving.
Well, I don't know, Mr.
Oh, that's great, pal.
It always comes back to the characters and the stories. You know, it doesn't matter whether you're looking at cell animation or whether it's live action or anything. The audience wants to be entertained. They want to have great stories and they want great characters. And that's what it came down to.
It's important to remember that these Droopy cartoons, like just about all the animated shorts being created at the time, were not intended for children. Sure, kids loved them, but these cartoons were produced mostly for movie-going adults. And in the case of many of Avery's cartoons, he was thinking primarily of one audience.
Bang!
America's fighting men. Thousands of war-weary soldiers lined up at bases all over the world. They wanted to see lots of pretty women, and Avery was happy to oblige them.
It's amazing that he did those sex-obsessed films at the MGM Studios, which was the bastion of, family values at that time.
Oh, hello, boy.
He was playing footsie a lot with the Hayes office, which was the censorship office. So he was well aware of walking a tightrope with going overboard. But in terms of wild gags, they were fine with it. Anything, you know, violent, they were fine with. But anything slightly sexy, they had a problem.
You know what? I'm happy.
So where did the Droopy character come from anyway?
A lot of what we saw on the screen was simply Tex Avery, the person.
If you've seen photographs of Avery, there's a certain, particularly as he got older, a droopy quality to him.
He had model sheets that were the most specific model sheets I ever seen in my life.
He's a hound. Droopy is to me a hound.
I'm happy. Hooray.
He had this wonderful little two-drawing walk. He would have Droopy as a matador one time.
It's me again.
A butler the next. It was just to find things for him to do, and that opened up, of course, other possibilities for occupations that could lead to gags.
Oh, you mean old bull.
Droopy was kind of a character that just had things happen to him.
He, I guess like Tex Avery, had a lot of passion underneath, because there are moments when he just lets go.
He was the little guy you favor. He's the literal underdog. He's also a Bugs Bunny type character in the sense that he kind of wins. He dominates the other characters in the end.
He was almost a cipher. He was just kind of there to have things happen to him, and then he'd just like utter some little, you know, very short reaction line.
Hello, Joe.
Well, Droopy moved very little. He just seemed to be there when he needed to be there.
Hello again.
One of the most unique things about Droopy was his distinctive sad sack voice, a lazy southern drawl that seemed perfect for this slow-moving character.
I'm a failure.
Hello, all you happy people.
You know what? I'm jolly.
While all of Tex Avery's action moved a mile a minute, it came screeching to a halt every time Droopy spoke.
You dropped your wallet, sir.
That made everything Droopy said even funnier.
Droopy had a very low, slow, lethargic kind of voice that was provided by Bill Thompson. The voice fit the character so well.
Cheaters never win.
Just sounded like he should sound. Of course, when he goes wild and, you know, screams and all that, it's a whole other voice comes out of there.
Thank you, sir.
With Tex Avery, cartoons were all about the gag. He wanted people to laugh until it hurt. And with Droopy, Avery found the perfect partner to help him take the art of the gag to an entirely new level.
The Droopy cartoons are best known for their construction of gags.
There's a setup.
So it is my wish that this noble dog be the sole occupant of this residence. And the name of this most faithful dog is none other than Droopy.
So then you have 6 minutes of the bulldog trying to kill Droopy in different ways so he can get the inheritance. But they're known as try-fail gags, where he tries to kill Droopy, but then something goes wrong and it comes back on the bulldog. These things were structured not really as a plot so much as a beginning and an end, and in the middle you have all these great gags.
Draw one! Coming up!
Tex Avery, anything went, anything could happen, and did. We get these wonderful, super exaggerated takes.
He was one of the first guys that really, you know, broke the fourth wall quite a bit in having characters hold up signs to camera or making comments to the viewer.
I'm gonna tell you something right now, man. That there's a pretty smart little old dog in there.
There's a sequence where the wolf is running and running, and he runs so fast that he runs off the film frame. I think it was just a continuous need to find something that was a little bit different in each film.
Here we go again. Boo.
Many times in his films, the unexpected happens.
He would give you surprises constantly. I think that's probably the word, that his humor always surprised you, gave you something fresh out of something ordinary or familiar, which a lot of other studios, a lot of other directors would give you that, and you got what you expected. And he would always give you something a little off.
When you talk about humor, you're really talking about timing. And when it came to cartoons, nobody's timing was better than Tex Avery's.
Tex's sense of timing was crucial.
Tex Avery loved to give us a gag, then wait just a beat, and give us a second one. Then, a beat later, he'd give us a third.
The timing is razor sharp. The pacing is breakneck speed. Avery, you know, reveled in that. First of all, he speeded up the action. He made it very fast. And if one gag didn't work, another might. He commented on the action.
Now there's a well-built doghouse, man.
He would take a gag and he would constantly be tinkering with the timing of it and the payoff. I never asked him this, but I always got the sense that he was like trying to create the perfect gag.
Taking the finished film and cutting frames out of it to make it move faster. And then pasting it back together. So he was never satisfied.
If something got laughs here, he'd say, well, that got laughs, but how could I make it get bigger laughs? So he'd bring it back in a different form with a different character.
You know what? The hero always comes out in the end.
Today, this drawling dog continues to give new generations the gift of laughter. And Tex Avery's legend continues to grow.
He is part of pop culture in France and in several European territories. Everybody knows the name Tex Avery. They had a number of cartoon festivals and homages to him that were on television. And like Jerry Lewis, I think they became aware of him through that.
Many people believe he's one of the greatest cartoon directors of all time. And in fact, he was probably the most influential of the Hollywood cartoon studio directors after Walt Disney. Whereas Disney wanted to draw you in and make you believe that these cartoons were real, Tex Avery didn't care about that. He wanted to go the opposite direction. He once said, I did things that Disney wouldn't dare to do.
I think Tex's work influenced just about all the great cartoon directors, whether it's Chuck Jones, Bob Clampett, Hanna-Barbera, all the great gag cartoon directors. Whenever I've read interviews of them, they always cite Tex as like being the guy they wished they were. And it's also interesting that Tex was, of all those guys, probably the least determined to be famous on his own. I never got the sense that Tex really cared about fame and fortune as much as he was just an obsessive cartoonist. And I think that's another reason. I mean, Droopy's really his only well-known continuing character. With Tex, the characters weren't as important as the gags.
There are moments when he just lets go and then pulls himself back together again. There was this sort of, wild man waiting to get out, like Tex Avery. I think that he was very much like his creator.
So, the next time you watch a cartoon and you laugh really hard, well, you can thank Tex Avery, the guy who decided that since anything can happen in a cartoon, maybe there are no rules. Maybe it's all just one big gag.
Get out of here.
They're just so funny. They're among the funniest cartoons that you'll ever see.
I think Tex was the kind of guy that knew exactly what he wanted almost all the time. He always struck me as a guy that really had made the cartoon already in his head.
Some people have a gift and it just flows out of them. It's something that starts here in the heart and goes up to the brain and comes out the arm and the hand and on paper, and there it is. Tex was a genius.
Well, who did you expect to see? The president?
Hey, now, wait a minute, shorty. You've been a-dogging me all through this picture. Just who the heck are you, anyway?
Why, haven't you heard? I'm the hero.